thanks for tuning in and listening to us this day. It's October 2020. And my name is Nina Santus. I'm a clinical assistant professor in the Communication Sciences and Speech Disorders Department here at the College of Ed in Athens, Georgia, University of Georgia. And I am joined with my colleague, Nancy Dellaria.
Hi, I'm Nancy Dellaria, and I work at the University of Georgia. I am a clinical associate professor, and our main role is to work in our clinic, the UGA Speech and Hearing Clinic at UGA.
Right, so both of us supervise, and what that means is we have graduate students that are going through our speech language pathology program, and we actually have two cohorts, so we'll refer to them in this presentation as our first years and then our second years. And so the first years are going through their first year of graduate school in the area of speech pathology, and the second years are finishing their coursework and they're out on their internships. So you can start to think and imagine then, you know, what actually happens in terms of pedagogy and what we had to do when COVID hit in March. So we're going to be talking about that today. And Nancy's going to kind of walk you through what a typical session looked like in our clinic before we had to pivot to telepractice.
So back in March, we were in spring semester 2020, and we, our first year students in graduate school, we're seeing our clients in our clinic, and they usually see them one-on-one or in a group setting, and they're working with adults and pediatrics who have various types of communication disorders, and we oversee that and supervise that directly and guide them through those sessions, and that's what they typically do during the first year. They gain their clinical clock hours at our clinic. And for those of you, just a little background, we have an accredited program here, and our governing body is the American Speech, Language, and Hearing Association. So they set standards that we must abide by. And one of those standards is that our students need to accumulate 400 clock hours of clinical experience under supervision before they graduate, so with their master's. So you can imagine when COVID hit, that was a challenge we had to face. How could we continue to provide clinical clock hour and valuable experiences to our graduate students, as well as provide quality services to our clients? Because the clinic shut down along with the University of Georgia for face-to-face sessions. So Nina is going to talk a little bit about that now.
Yeah. And so you can imagine these students were used to face-to-face interaction with their clients, hands-on, tactile cueing, being able to touch the client, grabbing materials from what we call our ready room, tons of games and manipulatives, blocks. And so now, you know, all of a sudden we don't have that same human interaction. So you can imagine the changes that we had to go through with them in prepping for this whole shift. And what's funny about this shift is we were in the process when this all took place of hiring a new clinic director. And I remember asking her, Nancy, you know, we talked about this, that we asked her, how fast could we be up and running on telepractice? And lo and behold, a few weeks later, we needed to be. And so, you know, there was a shift in training the student, providing them with a list of materials now that are all electronic. Right now it's websites, and you'll see some of our pictures and images that we had, but, you know, from the telepractice that we've done so far, but you'll see images of, you know, everything's electronic now, games, links, finding ways to be creative and be effective in this new platform. So everything changed from client paperwork, instruction for the students, materials, problem-solving technology. Does the client have what they need in order to participate? Does the student have the technology? Do we as the supervisors have what we need? So just a huge shift there. So we took a lot of that semester to get things approved and passed, making sure that we could use Zoom for telehealth and that was approved. And so by May, we were piloting the program. And we know from research, we know from the literature, telepractice is not new to speech pathology, so we know it works. But this is the first time that we were having to use it and having to train students in it. So it was a complete shift. And wonderfully, it's something now that we know will never go away. Our clients, the outcomes are wonderfully the same. The data is there to support it. Our clients are making progress. Our students are still learning. And now we have our speech language pathologists, I'll often say SLPs in the field, calling and saying, what are you telling your students? What can your students show us in terms of how we can now treat during telepractice? Because we have SLPs all around us now in the community that are needing those same tools, materials, and so we're all sharing. So that was kind of our shift to telepractice. So that takes care of talking about our first year graduate students and our clients in the clinic. But then we had this whole second year cohort, right? They're out on their internships right now. They're in public schools, nursing homes, hospitals, and that's where it kind of got a little interesting, because once they're out there on their internships, we don't see them, we check in with them, but they're out there with their supervisor. So now we had to inherit this entire second year cohort. For the most part, wouldn't you say, Nancy, most of them, their internships shut down, right? Hospitals didn't have enough PPE to support them. Public schools were switching to telepractice or just stopping services.
Right. And for those sites that even remained open, they weren't allowing students in, to lower the risk of COVID spread, especially in nursing homes and medical settings. So we had 28 graduate students who were trying to finish up their internship. They usually do two internships, one in a public school and one in a medical setting. So you can imagine in March, when everything was shutting down nationally, our students were not able to continue practicing at these internship sites for the most part. So we had 28 students that were lacking their 400 clock hours that they needed to graduate, and graduation was coming up in May. So at this point, we had about 5 weeks to scramble and work through challenges to try to help these students gain those clock hours that they needed and clinical experiences and be able to graduate, hopefully, on time, whereas a lot of the programs across the nation were actually extending programs because their students were not able to get all their clinical clock hours. We were trying to figure out a way that we can make this happen and have them graduate in May.
Yeah. And so there are five of us, right? Clinical supervisors plus the clinic director. So there were six of us that took on the entire second year cohort. A huge, incredible amount of teamwork. And so the way we problem solve that in terms of pedagogy, right? Because now they're not getting that experience out in the field, but we used a program called SimuCase, and it's a simulation. And our governing body, ASHA, allows up to 75 hours of simulated training, thank goodness, right? So it's an online platform built to allow students to practice with virtual patients presented through avatars and videos. So cases on the platform are created by practicing speech language pathologists just like us. And they incorporate various types of data, right? So you have assessment reports, interviews with family members. Students have to answer questions to collaborate with other professionals. And so you'll see one of our pictures is a client on SimuCase, and the student has to go on and click on case study, right? Just like you would a regular chart review, ask good interview questions, listen to sample clips of their speech, collaborate with other medical professionals, and then it's either an evaluation that they're working on or a treatment that they're working on, and then they have to come up with results and recommendations. And so then our job after that, it has to be guided, right? So that we have to debrief with them. So we met with each of these students to talk about these simulations that they were running through, and we were there for them during it as well. And we pre-briefed before. So we would talk about the case. Okay, you're getting Fiona, a 20 something year old that stutters. And we talked about it. Then they would go through the simulation, and then we would meet and debrief with them. And so we would talk for 30 minutes to an hour with these students on the decisions they made and maybe what would have been better choices and why they did what they did. And it's a great program and we're thankful for it. And Nancy, you're gonna share all of the hours that they earned.
Yes. So again, it was a team approach. All of the clinical supervisors would oversee certain cases here, and we would debrief students. And we also had a certain group that we mentored through from start to finish to make sure that they were on track, our students were on track, gaining their clinical clock hours under their individualized plan that we had come up with for them. So, so what happened was by the time we were done, we had provided as a group 300 clinical clock hours to this group in a matter of 5 weeks through Simucase. And we were able to check our students off on 2,500 clinical competencies. So that was a huge accomplishment.
It's huge.
And
yeah,
it was a huge challenge that we all faced together. And we came out at the end, everyone actually graduated on time. And we were so thrilled.
Yeah, because students in other programs across the United States were not able to graduate on time. So we really were innovative in the way we were using these simulations in order to fulfill the hour requirement. And the students' feedback, they liked it, right? So it's not the same as being in front of another human being, but there was a lot of value in them. And that's why that program was designed. And so you'll get to see an image of that as well. And at the time of this recording, again, it's October of 2020, we're still facing these challenges. We're still in the pandemic. So we are, we now continue this fall to use telepractice. We're in telepractice in the UGA Speech and Hearing Clinic and Simucase. And we'll be checking on those now the second years that were the first years are now the second years. And we're checking on them in their internships right now, and seeing how much simulation they might need towards the end to continue graduating cohorts on time. So it's been a really challenging time, but it's been a really great time of teamwork and thinking outside of the box. We can't do things the way we used to in speech pathology in some ways. And so it's been really neat to see everybody come together, and the students too. So they're part of the team. And so they've really come together with us. And so we're continuing telepractice in some cases. And so we hope that this recording kind of helps, maybe you're in a different field, but kind of helps you understand us as a medical profession and what we needed to do in order to provide quality care for our clients and our students.
Thank you so much for this opportunity to share in the innovations of teaching. And we enjoy sharing our experiences of teaching during the global pandemic. Thank you.